Today's talk, data modeling examples. I've got roughly a half hour of slides or so. Two examples that we'll do in depth, and then I'll open it up to questions. If you have any other questions that you have about data modeling or algorithms in Cassandra, how you might model something, how you might do it, then this would be a good forum to ask it in. But starting off, I'm going to cover a general overview of goals that you want in Cassandra when you're modeling data, and then a few example questions to get us started, and then questions at the end. So really, the whole goal when you're modeling data in Cassandra is to keep data that you query together stored together on disk. How's that? Better in the back, can you hear? All right, so the whole goal of modeling data in Cassandra is to keep data that is queried together, stored together on disk. In comparison to a relational database or a something like Postgres or MySQL, when you end up putting data on there, it gets spread around the disk. And so when you query it, when you're doing these joins, you're actually having to seek randomly on disk. That's what gives you the poor performance once you get to very large data sets. So in a very general sense, you want to model your data so that when you're reading it, it's one seek and then it's read sequentially off of disk after that. Usually, you shouldn't try too hard to normalize your data. It's quite a bit different than what you would find in a relational system. You actually kind of want to denormalize it. It's very common in Cassandra to write the data multiple times. The write speeds are extremely fast and isn't going to impact your I/O a lot, so that's actually very cheap to do that. And then when it comes time to read the data, all the data that you actually care about is there. You have different views of the data, you'll just denormalize it multiple times. Then as just a general rule, it's usually better to keep a record of something happened as opposed to actually trying to change a counter. So if you have multiple states that you're going through, like a workflow, if a document gets submitted and then it gets signed and then it gets approved, it's probably better to have a row that has a column that says it's been submitted and then a different column that says it's been approved and then another one that says it's been signed, as opposed to having a single field that you change the value of. In a relational database, that's not important because you're essentially on one node, and so atomic transactions are very, very easy to perform there, and you can actually just start a transaction and update the field and then commit the transaction. Distributed systems, that's not quite as easy. So the first example I'm going to go through is time series data. It's easily the most common use case that people have in Cassandra. Just about everyone has some sort of time series data that they use. A couple examples that I've dealt with recently are financial tick data, clickstream, sensor data coming in from machines or vehicles, performance metrics on individual nodes or network switches or anything like that, GPS data, event logs, and so on and so forth. The thing to remember is that it's really all the same as far as Cassandra is concerned. You have things that happen in some timestamp ordered fashion. So you essentially have a stream of events and some data that's associated with them, either a single point of data or multiple points. For example, you know, every 30 seconds you get the location, speed, and heading, things like that. If you're doing financial data, ticks on quotes or trade information would be good examples of that. And then we're interested in reading that data later in a way that we can reconstruct the stream, either because we want to graph it, or we want to analyze it, or we want to see what was going on right before a failure happened, or pretty much anything like that. So each data point has 1 to n values, and each data point corresponds to a specific time interval. So when you map that to Cassandra, there's two parts of it. You want to use a composite row key, one for the stream that you're dealing with. Conceptually, you want one stream for all of your data, but that's not a realistic thing to do. If you're recording data over many years, it ends up getting too long. You get too many values in a row, or you get too much data on disk. So it's better to chop it up into some sort of bucket. So the column names are, is everyone familiar essentially with the Cassandra data model at the high level? Anyone not familiar with key spaces, column families, rows, and column names? Okay, so Cassandra has, at the top level, a key space. So a logical grouping of column families. Each key space contains multiple column families. Each column family contains multiple rows. Each row has a row key associated with it. With that row key is associated any number of columns. A column consists of a name and a value, or a key and a value, however you want to think about it. So they're essentially tuples. So a row key, a single key, maps to a ordered list of tuples. They're ordered by the key in that column, the column name, if you will. If you think of it as a giant hash map, then it's ordered by the key in the hash map. A bunch of those rows fit in a column family, multiple column families inside of a key space. So when I talk about the row key, I'm talking about that identifier for a whole stream of columns, where it can be one to many. That's entirely different from a relational system that has a fixed schema. You say, here's a table, it has seven columns. It always has seven columns, never more, never less. Cassandra doesn't have that. Cassandra has a row key that is associated to any number of columns. So the column name, that key in that tuple, in that ordered list of tuples, is a time UUID. A time UUID is ordered by timestamp. It has a time component of when it was generated, but being a UUID, it's also guaranteed to be unique among any other that is generated, even at the same time. So if you have events that are coming in, and they might have two different events that happen at exactly the same moment in time, you want to use a time UUID to disambiguate them, to make sure that the IDs are unique. Instead of having a single timestamp, if you did that, then you would have one that overwrites the other, and you would lose the data you had there. If you're guaranteed to know that no two events within a single row, within a single stream, will ever be happening at the same time, then you can just use a timestamp, which is a little bit more efficient both in terms of storage and CPU. And then the value that you put in there is the serialized metrics that you're collecting, whatever it is. If you're collecting capacity of disk space, CPU usage, memory usage, then you serialize that and you write it into the column value. Whatever you use to serialize that doesn't really matter, JSON or XML, Java serialized objects, it's all the same, whatever your favorite serialization format is. The bucketing is that second part of the key up there where it says January 2011. That's the time part of the bucket. That limits the size of the rows that you have. They're never going to grow past a certain value. In this case, all the data that is in that first row is going to be in January of 2011. That would be the timestamp that's associated with it. Or if you wanted to do it by day instead of by month, it would be January 1st, 2011. The actual format you use for those are not really important. You can encode them in integers. You can actually use a 64-bit timestamp for the number of seconds since epoch. You can literally put the string January 01, 2001. Not really relevant. It's just going to get hashed. It's going to be an array of bytes. There's no ordering properties that you have to worry about there. So the whole point of that is that you don't want to have to do multiple seeks when you request it. It makes it easy to aggregate the stream information later. So if you have all the information for January and you're collecting, you know, maybe quote information from a market stream, every tick that comes in gets put in there for that month. Or in the case of quote data, you would probably do it by day because of the number of values you have. If you want to aggregate over all of those and calculate averages or highs and lows or moving averages within the day, then it makes it very easy to do this because you know at the end of the day, once the date has rolled over, that no more data is being added to that row. And you can read that row and be sure that you've got a consistent view of it and that nothing else is being there. So you can actually do your aggregations and write those back to Cassandra under a different row key, essentially as a lazy cache optimization there. So it makes it very easy to do that when you bucketed it to be able to query the entire row and do those aggregations and write them back. The last part on there is actually a practical limitation of Cassandra, is that if you limit the size of the row eventually, it's going to get compacted, which is Cassandra's process for merging old data or duplicate data that you've overwritten, and put it back on disk in one place. It's never going to be touched again, and so it never has to be, you never have to do multiple seeks to read it. Cassandra does a merge on read when you have multiple values of the data that's spread across disk. When you read, it gets some pieces from one SS table and some pieces from another SS table, and then it merges the results and gives you a response. Once it's been compacted, if you're never adding any more data to that same row key, then you're guaranteed you're only ever going to do a single seek. So a little bit more of a concrete example would be sensor data from airplanes. Every 30 seconds, I'm going to collect some metrics about it. So the visual representation for how I like to draw that is I have the row key, in this case would be, you know, plane 5 for January 2011. And then I have a time UUID, in this case would be the earliest that something has happened. Depending on the order that you sorted in, either ascending or descending, then the first column is the earliest or the oldest, or the newest or the most latest. You get to choose that in the configuration, whether you want things sorted ascending or descending. The top row here, where it says all the time UIDs, those would be the keys in the columns. So this whole thing would be a row. Each of these verticals is a single column, which has a name or a key, and then a value. And then this is the row key for that sorted list. The list goes on pretty much infinitely. Millions of columns is not going to be a problem for Cassandra, and it's common to find rows that only have one or two columns. So in this case, at whatever timestamp the UUID 0 corresponded to, the plane was at some location at some altitude and had some percentage remaining. That makes sense? Yes?
Can you explain more about the decision to use time UUID, what you mean by that? Is this just like number of seconds is the epoch or something?
Sure. So the question is, can I explain a little more about why time UUIDs instead of number of seconds since the epoch, or what the various trade-offs or options are there? If I had the possibility of two events coming in that could happen at the same time, meaning that when I write the data, they come in as two discrete events, but they happened at the same timestamp. When I write them, only one of them is going to be persisted to the database. Because for every row, you can only have a single column with that name in it. So if I have something that happened at timestamp 0 and something that happened at timestamp 0, but they had different data, if I wrote this one first, when this one comes in, it'll overwrite it. If I did it the other way, then this one wins. Really what I want, because they're two different events that happen to have, just out of chance, happened at the same time, I actually want to keep both of them. That's what the time UUID does. The time UUID comparator in Cassandra orders things by timestamp. So a time UUID has in it a timestamp component. It also has a bunch of other information, some randomization and some stuff based on the MAC address, and then a counter within the process that is actually generating these. If I take two different timestamps and I generate two different, and ask for a time UUID for them, I'm going to get two different time UUIDs. Because they have the same timestamp, I'm guaranteed that Cassandra will put them together in the row, you know, right in the middle of the row. It may be A and B or B and A, but whatever it is going to be consistent across all the nodes. All the nodes are going to agree on exactly the same order because they're going to sort by the timestamp component first, and finding that those are equal, then we'll look at the other parts of the UUID and make a determination of which one comes first or last. Yes?
So you said something about you want to reduce the number of times you have to compact a row. Something like that, right? Like you don't want to make your data set, you want to choose your data in such a way that you don't have to go back to earlier data to compact it.
Yeah. No. Compaction is the process that Cassandra does to take duplicate or redundant information or old information that is no longer needed on disk and clean it up. It's essentially garbage collection. The way Cassandra works is you write a bunch of values, they go into a memtable. They're held in memory for a little bit. That eventually hits some threshold and we write it to disk. When we write it to disk, we sort the rows that we're writing by the column names, and then we put it on disk and it's unmodifiable. We never change that data. We go back later and do a compaction, which I'll talk about in just a second, but we call that an SS table. So if I write three columns, say, first three columns in January, and then I hit that threshold and I put those three columns on disk, later, when I add more columns, that's eventually going to go to a different file, a different SS table on disk. And what I'm gonna have is for a single row, I'm gonna have part of it in one SS table and part of it in another. Compaction is the process that looks at those SS tables and reads them and says, wow, there's a partial piece here and a partial piece here. Let me put those together and put those at a different place on disk. And after it scans through both of those SS tables like that and rewrites everything that needs to be merged, which by the way is relatively efficient because these are sorted in the order you're going to do them. So you can read them basically two streams directly off of disk and then do a merge join on them and then write it out. After that's done, it deletes these two old values. And then you've just got this new SS table. Yes?
Can you determine the time in which the write request was submitted from the time UUID and have it guaranteed to match the real world and not just when Cassandra managed to write this?
No, you can't guarantee that it matches the real world in general in any. You pick the timestamp that you're writing here. The client does. When you're writing the data, the client application, not Cassandra, says, I have a timestamp, and this is when the data happened. And if you were buffering up writes, you might generate the timestamp 5 minutes ago. Or in the case of, if this was literally an airplane sending data, I would expect the airplane to be telling me what time it generated the data. I don't want to worry about links and satellites and, you know, multiple hops and all of that. The airplane has an accurate clock. If the sensor has an accurate clock of when it happened, that's the timestamp it should use. It should send that data along. And then you use that to generate your time UUID. That make sense?
Yeah.
Yeah. Yes?
In this example, could we have named the column family as the rookie? I mean, instead of 85 and 2007 as the column family, and then have the time UUID as the rookie, and then have the key value pair as the.
Can you explain the other approach briefly?
So you name the column family as play 5 Jan 2011, and then you have the row key as the tag UID.
No, no, this is the row key. Plane 5 January 11 is the row key. So this is a single row within a column family.
What about the other approach of having tag UID as the row key, and then have the column family, so you can basically have the.
Okay, yes. So the question is, what about if you essentially pivoted this so that you had a time UUID as the row key, and then you had a bunch of values for different planes that were in there at that time? That depends on how you want to query the information. If you are interested in recreating a stream for a plane, if I want to know what plane 5 was doing, this is the best structure for that. Because all the data that I care about is here, and nothing I don't care about is there. The limit to the number of row keys in Cassandra? Billions, easily. There are many multiple production systems that have many billions of row keys right now, and they're actually not even the largest clusters. To finish up your question though, pivoting it like that, there is a reason to do that. If I was not interested in what plane 5 was doing, but if the queries I was asking for is, what were all of my planes doing at 2 p.m. on Monday, then I would want to have 2 p.m. on Monday as a row key, and then all the information for my planes across the row like that. That's why I was saying early on, the general idea, the overriding goal you want to keep in your mind when you're modeling data in Cassandra is that you want to put data you query together on disk together. That is the key to performance. Everything else derives from that. Yes? No, you want to put it into a single row because that's how it's actually stored on disk. What you said is true. A single row is only on, a single row is never split across multiple replicas. If your replication factor is 3, for example, for a given row, it will be on 3 nodes. The entirety of that row will be on 3 nodes. The other nodes will not have any portion of that row. But the reason that you do it is to get it on disk together, not just on the same node, but on the same disk and sequentially on disk, consecutively written out so that you only seek one time and you read it. If you're using SSDs, these rules generally don't apply. But the seek time of a disk is roughly about 10 milliseconds. That's way longer than it takes you to send it across the wire, to deserialize it, to compare it on a CPU. All of that is dwarfed by the seek time. So how do you reduce the seek time? I do less seeks. Putting all the data together that I care about in precisely one place means that I can do less seeks. Yes?
Regarding the merge, when you read data, you said like, just for the two data tables, I'm putting to one place, right? So when you write, the row data table has all the data, not just those columns.
I'm sorry, say that last part. When you write, this SS table has all the data, and then what? So when you write, it goes into a memtable first, which is essentially a glorified hash map of ordered column values. It looks very similar to this. This would be, in memory, this would be the key for the hash map, and then the value for that hash map would be this ordered list, which is also a hash map by names. And then when there would be a different row that has a different key, like for plane 7 or for February, that would be a different row with different columns in it. And all of those go into essentially one memory location, one spot in memory. When you reach that threshold, then we flush those to disk, and that becomes an SS table. An SS table is essentially an on-disk representation of a mem table. SS table is historical naming. It stands for sorted string table, when keys used to be strings, but now they're not. Does that answer your question? They only have the ones you've written since the last time it was flushed. They don't have all of them. Yes? I'm sorry, a little louder? The question is, why serialization instead of super columns? So mainly super columns are evil. That's my opinion. But there's a little bit of truth behind that. Super columns, when you read them, you have to deserialize the entire thing. Now, that's exactly true when I'm serializing it in JSON or protobuf or whatever. The difference is that because Cassandra sees it as a single value, it can just move that block of memory around. It doesn't have to actually look at it. It sees, if you serialize it all as protobuf and you write it in there, then Cassandra sees some array of bytes that has some size, and it just puts that on disk. When you need to read it back, it goes, oh, you want the 173 bytes at this location. Okay, great, here you go. When it's a super column, it has to read those off, and it has to deserialize every column, every subcolumn that's in there. And then now it has this deserialized super column in memory, and it goes, oh, now I need to write this across the wire. I know, I'll serialize it again into Thrift, and then I'll send it across the wire. So it's that round trip and having to actually look at the data, where protobuf, you do that on the client, and you do that precisely one time right before you read it. The downside is you can't change one of the fields if you serialize this as JSON or protocol buffers or something like that. You'll get race conditions if you want to do that. In this particular example, where I'm getting sensor data or stock quotes or web clicks, I don't change those fields. It's a real event that happened in the real world. You know, once it's happened, I have the data about it, and then I write it. Later, I may attach more data onto it, but I'm not ever going back and changing those original values. So essentially, performance, and because I don't like super columns. Yes? One more time, this storage choice I made. Yes. No, not with this structure. You would have to index that separately. The way you would do that is you would have something that says 44,000 feet and maybe some other month that you have on there, or bucket, if you were interested in who was at 44,000 feet in January or at 2 p.m. or whatever that is. Then you would have a row key for that, and then as the values, you would have all the plane IDs. And then whenever you wanted to query that, you would say, go give me the row key, 44,000 feet in January. Yes, you'd be storing that piece of information multiple times if you needed to query across all of these. If you had a bunch of different attributes and you need to query all of them, then you would probably be storing it multiple times. That's the denormalization part of Cassandra. It wastes a little bit of storage in most cases, but the performance gains that you get when reading it are substantial. Honestly, if this was my only data, if I only cared about three attributes in my sensor, I would store it three times. For every value I got, I'd write it under the plane, then I'd write it under the location, and then the altitude, and then the remaining. I'm sorry, four times in that case. It's not that much extra storage. And then when I read, all the things I care about are right there. Yes? If what? The counts for the row key. You can ask for the counts on a row key. It does the same thing that non-indexed row counts in a relational database does, i.e., it counts them. It reads them off of disk, and it counts them. The only thing you're saving is the network traffic. Actually, in some cases, you're not even saving the network traffic, because if you're reading at a higher consistency level, it's still going across the network to other nodes, but it's not going back to the client. If you need to keep counts of things that are in here, there are a couple of different ways to do that. There are counter columns that you can use. The API is fairly straightforward there. You can also do aggregations afterwards. So at the end of the month, if it doesn't need to be real time, at the end of the month, you can go do this very expensive count and read the whole row, and then write the results somewhere else. That's one of the reasons that you bucket your time, because once that time period passes, you know you can make lasting choices about the data there. You can analyze it, and you know the result's not changing anymore. Do you have a, yes? Yes? It's perfectly fine if it pushes it the last couple seconds of the month. Whatever timestamp it gets, it's going into that bucket.
You want to know the last hour of sensor data, or you don't really want to know January 2001, you want to know last 30 minutes.
So that's actually very efficient in this as well, because I know the last 30 minutes is in December, being December right now. So I know what my row key is, because I know I encoded things or bucketed things by month. And I know what the timestamp of now is, and I can give it a little bit of error tolerance if I'd like. If I think my clock skew is 2 minutes, then I will take now plus 2 minutes as the, I will take now minus 2 minutes as, now minus 32 minutes and now plus 2 minutes as the start and end, and then I can pull that slice out. So there's an API in Cassandra that says, given a row key and a start and end column, I want everything between the start and end. And so if you're only interested in the last 30 minutes, it's a little bit better than that if you're only interested in the last 30 minutes. If you want some 30 minutes out of the middle, you specify a start and an end, and then you pull that out. And that's, again, it's a seek to the row, read the row index, jump to where the column is, sequential scan of your data, and you're done. You're not seeking multiple places. In the case of the last 30 minutes, you don't need to give it a start. You just give it an end. You know, now minus 30 is your end column, and you say, whatever my most recent stuff is up until 30 minutes ago. Does that answer your question?
Yeah.
In a general sense, though, yes, if you're writing timestamps from the client, then that's up to the client to make sure that they're synchronized as well as they can. Oh, it depends on what you're doing with the data. If you are trying to use this to detect real-time collisions, don't do that. Have a real-time clock. I had a case study in college as a real-time systems in EE. It's a massive failure of two planes. They hit midair, and it happened twice in the same, like, 18 months or something, because they didn't synchronize their clocks. They basically set the clocks and then sent them up. If you're going to do stuff like that, then you need a real-time clock. If I'm just looking for reporting or, you know, mileage or fuel burn or something like that, then just a standard, GPS clock works well. In the case of airplanes, they actually do have very accurate clocks, and that they are pretty synchronized to about a quarter of a second within each other. I'm sure there are several. Not sure what you're getting at here, but you can have skew in your clocks. You can have, if you're using the timestamp on the columns and you have clock skew and you write the same column name, then you might get the wrong value that you want to have in there. That's part of why you have a time UUID, so that no matter who generates it, when or where, you're guaranteed for it to be unique. So at least you have all the data you received. if that's something you care about, if there is a logical consequence for that, when you read it back, you have that data there, and you can look at it and go, wait, that doesn't make sense. I'm not supposed to have two of these, but I do. And the reason you have two of them is because that's the reality, that's what happened. You wrote two of them, and if that wasn't supposed to happen, then at least you've detected it. Yes? So if I'm overwriting the data, essentially there's always the possibility of race conditions. If I have one flag for a workflow I'm going through, if I'm tracking, you know, some car going around a track, I want to know when it's 25%, then 50%, then 75%, then 100%. If I'm overwriting the values, it's very possible that two things detect that it's at 25%, and they send writes. And so one of them goes in there, and then right after that, this third party detects, oh, it's at 50% now, and it sends a write. And so it goes 25, 50, and now this write for 25% went around a bunch of hops on the internet and then landed on there and overwrote your 50%. That's essentially the race condition you have. And so now you've recorded the wrong data, even though all of the independent actors were all acting in their own best interest. None of them were being malicious. There's no bug in your code for that sense. They all detected an event and they wrote it. If I was keeping a record of it being there, then these two that are writing 25%, the write goes in and it says, I've got 25%. This write goes in that says, I've got 50%, but it doesn't overwrite this. It's a separate marker for it. And then this write comes in and says, I got 25%. Because you're keeping a record of each one instead of overwriting the 50%, it overwrites the thing that has the same value. It's basically guaranteeing idempotency. In general, idempotency is a wonderful property to have, should be a goal in any distributed system. Actually, screw that. It should be a goal in every system. It's not always possible, but it's a good thing to have. When you're overwriting the data, now the order matters. And now, you know, simple things, network failures, you know, routing failures, delays, buffer overflows that get queued up too long and take too long to process, you know, slow machines, restarts, all of those affect the final value of your system. When you're keeping a record of what happened as three separate columns, instead of changing the value each time, that can't happen. Yes? I'm sorry, I can't hear you at all. Can you yell, please? You can't index to. Are you asking how do I find different values in the row? So you have multiple attributes you want to search the data on. So you could query for, there's a couple different ways to do that, and it basically depends on the distribution of the attributes you have on how you want to do that. In this case, let's say I wanted to know all the planes that were between, you know, 45,000 and 46,000 feet, then I can probably actually have a row key for that says between 45,000 and 46,000. Maybe I'm only interested, though, in planes that are between 45,203 and 45,207. Very specific narrow range, then in that index that has 45 to 46,000 feet, I can have the column names be the actual altitude of the plane. And so then I can do a slice on that. I know the range I'm looking for, so that gives me my row key. That puts me on a smaller set of nodes than I have originally. So I start with all my nodes in the cluster, and then I've narrowed it down to the replicas for the row that I'm looking for. And then the row key reads the index, and that gets me to where I want on the disk for that data. The column index will then put me somewhere in the middle of that row for all things that are between whatever very specific value that you wanted. If you had to query before that and another attribute, then you can essentially do that join in memory if you're expecting a relatively small number of results. These results come back sorted. They come back in order, so you can do a merge join on them very efficiently. So that would be an example of finding planes at a particular altitude at some point. And then if you also wanted to do that, you know, you were only interested in 747s, then you could go look at your other index that would tell you all the planes that are 747s. And then as you're pulling back these values, you look at them and say, oh, they match, okay, there's one. Oh, they don't. Let me move down this list, move down this list. Oh, I found another match. Yes? Plain ID and then what?
Plain ID and some other identifier, like some kind of, you know, airline group ID or something where you can know the whole universe. And you want to be able to query long rows that's for a certain plane. Would it make more sense to have like a secondary index in some kind of column or have another column that stores?
You can do that, but I would actually use a separate column family, which is contrary to advice I used to give back in .6, early .7. Probably even .7 now. I would have a separate column family now. One of the talks, or one of the things that Jonathan Ellis was talking about this morning in his keynote, is that we basically have one unified, you know, caching structure and better tuning of the memtable. You don't set per memtable, or sorry, per column family, your memory settings. And so you can actually have many, many column families now, and it's not a problem. The good news about that, when you're doing that as well, is because they're in separate column families, they're actually completely separate on disk. So if you're tracking, you know, big giant megacorp airplane corporation that's reading and writing all the time, and mom and pop out of Alaska, you know, if one of them's not being read, it's just out of the way on disk. It's not in the cache, it's not in the page cache, it's not having to be, you know, put in the index for that column family. So it actually makes things quite a bit more efficient. Secondary indexes you can certainly do on that. That depends on how many things you have and how many you expect to get returned in the query. Secondary indexes don't work all that well for things that match a lot of, things that match very few rows. So if I had only a few rows from particular companies and that was the normal thing that I searched for, I wouldn't use a secondary index for that. If I expected many matches, then I would. So the canonical example I use to describe this is secondary indexes are not for email addresses. They should mostly be unique. Maybe you have a collision somewhere else, someone screwed up, or there's a bug or whatever. But generally, an email address is unique. So I don't want to query for that. If I have a row of users with one column that's the email address, I don't put a secondary index on that because it's only going to match one row. I'm going to have to talk to a bunch of nodes to find that. They're all going to do a fair amount of work. It works. It's correct. But performance-wise, really not the best. Where if I wanted to know all the people that work in New York, that's a good use for that. I expect to have many, many results come back from that if I'm going to scan through it. Yes?
I have a real-world scenario where I have data from different providers, data providers. I need to segregate that data to a degree. Say, for example, I have to store statistical data, say, three or four different providers. Same data or similar data, but also I need to be initially segregated, and then I can get it rolled up into a master, depending on proof and trust of the stack. The other side of that is that also the users of the system and the users are restricted to which staff providers they can view. So we looked at a couple of ways of doing it. One would be just to segregate from our key space and aggregate later on, but I was curious whether it's difficult to aggregate around our key spaces or whether there's another way you might recommend it.
Just to make sure I understood the question correctly, you have different providers of essentially the same data. So they're all sending you the same thing, but they're from different feeds, and they need to be separated from one another so that they don't collide or overwrite each other. And then there are security concerns around that about who can read pieces of those data. And then depending on the provider it came from, and then after that you do some aggregation into some big massive thing. Okay, there are a couple ways to do that. You can put them in separate column families. Depends on how strong the security concerns you want. You essentially need to be dealing with that in your application, but you can put them in separate column families, which would keep the data completely separate, and then when you need to read it, you'd want to give them the same row keys against all of those column families. So when you read it, you can read from all those column families under the same row key, and you know where the data is, and you can aggregate it that and put it in another column family. You can also put it as different columns within the same row in a single column family. So whatever you're using for your column name, in the case of like a market feed, for example, you would probably have the timestamp or a sequence number that you get from your provider. You can concatenate that with the provider name and make that your column name. So now you still have all your data sorted in order in a single row, but you have, you know, provider A, B, C, D for timestamp one, and then provider A, B, C, D for timestamp two, and it goes in blocks of four like that. That's useful if you always want all of the provider data back at the same time. If you want to know individual provider data, if sometimes you query just for provider A or just for provider B, then you want to put those in different column families or in different rows. That make sense? Yeah. I think we've got a few minutes left, so I'm going to try to very quickly go through these and then hopefully have a little bit more time for questions on the end. I'm sorry, I'm standing over here. I can't actually see the slides on my laptop for some reason. Yeah, we talked about that you basically have the start and end of a slice to pull it out somewhere in the middle, or in the case that you want the very last or newest, you can just use empty columns on there. So how do you choose your bucket size? This is actually kind of a very common question that comes up. It depends on a whole lot of different things. It depends on how you query your data, how big your data points are, how fast you're writing, the I/O capacity on the nodes, pretty much everything. So it's kind of hard to answer. But there are some guidelines. No bigger than, you know, a few gigs per row is a good guideline. You can calculate that by, you know, how big my bucket size is. Is it a month or is it a day? And then how fast am I writing? So if I'm writing 10 values per day and I have a bucket size of 1 day and then I have a size of a data point of 10, then that's very small. That's, you know, 100 bytes or whatever. That's not a few gigs. So go bigger. After that, you have the bucket size needs to be greater than or equal to the average slice that you query for. It's a good rule of thumb to follow. If you're normally querying for a day of data or a half hour of data, make sure your bucket size is at least that. If you're normally querying for, you know, 5 minutes, then that's very easy. If you're normally querying for a month of data, then it gets a little bit harder because you might, storing a month of data may violate some of these other constraints. So you kind of need to weigh the trade-offs of each of these. Sometimes you can't have all of them. And I'd say no more than 10 million or so entries per row. That's more or less a number I pull out of the air based on average hardware deployments that I've seen of what they can handle. Your number may vary. And in general, a month is usually what I start at and then see if there's a reason to change it. There are exceptions to all of these rules. So if they don't work, or if you find that it's broken for you, sorry, but you know, we'd be glad to help, but they're just guidelines. Ordering in terms of performance, two links on here, we'll put the slides up later. You should go read those, they're interesting. If you are always asking for things in a particular order, then you should make sure that you're writing them in that order on disk so that you don't have to do a reverse. Obviously, you can ask for slices that go across a bucket. If you're bucketing by month, you could ask for something between, you know, January 15th and February 15th. Well, you have to break that up a little bit. That means you get two row keys, but you can ask for the same slice. You can do that in multi-get all at once and then get the data back. If you're going to expire streams after a while, you know, you're collecting data and bucketing it by month and you only want to keep it for a year, TTLs are your friend. They're awesome. You should use those. Don't write jobs that go through and delete stuff later. It's just more headache than it's worth. If you're only interested in counters things, very small adaptation to this. Basically, the values become counter columns, but otherwise it's the same. You can aggregate those. This is what that would look like. I'm sorry, I seriously have like 2 minutes, so. My favorite pattern actually in Cassandra is eventually atomic, and what that is if I have a bunch of things that I want to write to different row keys, if I have a bunch of values that I need to write in the system and they need to be indivisible to keep the consistency of my database, the way you do that is very easy in a relational database. You say start transaction, you make your changes, you say commit. The reason it's easy for them to do that is because they're on one node or they're in a master-slave setup where they're just replicating it to other nodes. That's very hard to do and ill-advised in a distributed system. And in the strictest sense of the word, it's actually an impossibility. It can't be done. Depends on your definition of ACID and strictness, but nonetheless, it is certainly ill-advised. So what I like to do in Cassandra is essentially implement a transaction log on top of Cassandra. If I'm going to change three different values and three different row keys, put those all together in JSON or protobuf or message pack, whatever you'd like, write it somewhere so that it's durable on Cassandra, go perform each of those transactions, and then delete this. If I fail anywhere along that, I have a record that I was going to do it, that I've started the transaction, and when I see that, I can go replay it. And because writes are idempotent in Cassandra, I can do this as many times as needed, and I can do it while the entire system is up. This is essentially the same thing that Postgres and Oracle and everyone else does. It's essentially a write ahead log, but it doesn't really have the isolation. So the row key is just a randomly chosen node token. You just essentially ask the cluster, what nodes are there? And it tells you, and then you randomly pick one of those, and that becomes your row key. And then you use a time UUID of, you know, about nowish, whatever your low resolution timestamp clock is, and you write that in there. Then you go perform your actions, and then you delete that. I'll go back to that slide in just a second. So you can go through the failures pretty easily. If you fail before you insert into the transaction log, then it's like it never happened in the first place. That's exactly the same as a relational database. If you insert it into that, but then you fail before you perform any actions, that's also exactly the same as a relational database. Actually, I'm sorry, that's not true. This will eventually perform those actions for you when it recovers, and a relational database will roll back the transaction. The corollary there is that when you commit a transaction in a relational database, you're saying commit and those things become live. The Cassandra analogy to that is when you insert it into the transaction log, that is essentially a commit. At that point, those changes will be made eventually, not right away. If you fail after insert, but in the middle of the actions, it's really the same. Someone's going to come by and find this marker in your transaction log and go, oh, I need to replay that. And because writes are idempotent, you replay the whole thing in its entirety. You don't even need to know which step it failed at, because you're going to replay the whole thing. And if you do it after insert and after the actions, but before you delete it, it's not a problem. A little bit of wasted work because you're going to replay something you didn't need to, but very small. It doesn't really matter most of the time because normally things are working correctly and nobody's replaying anything. It's only in the failure cases that things become interesting. So a couple settings if you're doing this, you want a real short GC grace seconds on that because you're going to be adding and deleting among a relatively small number of rows. And so you want to be able to do that very quickly. You don't need to keep the data around. And if I miss a write somehow, or somehow I'm not waiting long enough for GC grace and I get columns that come back because a node was down longer than 5 minutes, I don't care because it's just a little bit of wasted work. So it really optimizes more for throughput and then handles the failure cases. In terms of recovery, you just query for those all the time, periodically, however fast you want to do it. Normally, you will not find any values, and you'll continue on because normally everything's working fine. And when you do find one, you just replay it. And that's it. Thank you.